Listen to the sound of the falling rain, telling me what a fool I've been. As long as it's been coming down. As long as I remember, it's been coming down. Clouds of mystery, something confusion on the ground. Who will stop the rain? Who will stop the rain? And I wonder, still I wonder, who will stop the rain? The rain of relativism. Who will stop the rain of relativism? Well, it stops when we step off the branch, the articulated branch of relativism, into the ever buoyant buoyancy. It's buoyancy within buoyancy. That's how secure it is. That's how secure it is. And we glide. We float, we glide in the realization of the non-relative. But how do we just take that tiny, tiny little lean, just lean a little bit and float? How do we do that? Well, not many have. Because they don't have a plan for it. They just think, well, maybe someday it'll happen. I don't know. Be nice if it did. But in the meantime, but we have a plan here. We have a plan. Thanks to the Holy Spirit. Thanks to the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is a marvel. It is formless. It is timeless. You can't pin it down. You can't see it. You can't make it into a thing. It just is, I call it pure pragmatism. It is sheer, pure pragmatism. Entirely. And as such, sometimes we don't seem to be able to get help from it because we're looking for what's unpragmatic. And we just have to be quiet, we just have to be still, we just have to settle down, we have to repent, we say I have a severe continuity problem, it's very important I get help with this. Please, Holy Spirit, can you suggest something? The Holy Spirit suggests. It doesn't order, it doesn't insist, it doesn't, you know, it's not forcing anything on you. It will suggest, and you have to ask, you have to ask. Could you please suggest something? And then be quiet, be still, and wait for the answer. And the answer will come in a way which you don't may not expect. It just seems organic and natural, and just you'll say, oh, why don't I try this? As if it's your own idea. Like, why don't I try this? Well, it seems like it's coming from your own mind, and it is, because the Holy Spirit is within your mind. It is one with your mind. It's not separate from it. But it's coming from the mind which knows itself to be the mind instead of the idea of trying to change the mind. So you'll say, oh, hey, well, if I try this, maybe this will work, or this will be good. So I simply ask the Holy Spirit for what practice can I use this morning, right now? What is going to be effective? Can you suggest what's effective, what I should be doing right now, just today, right now? And then wait for the answer. Or I say, what can be helpful for the world? What can be shared with everyone that will help us all on this journey beyond words get there, you know, actually get there? And something will come up if I'm diligent and pay attention. Sometimes my mind's too distracted, and I think I've got my own idea of what I need to do or not do, and That's a problem. First things first in the morning. So it's the Holy Spirit first. It's the Holy Spirit first. The pure voice of pure pragmatism. You don't have to turn it into a religious thing. It's the voice of pure pragmatism. What works? The Holy Spirit knows what works to bring us beyond this relativism of concepts, of words, of imagination, of symbols, of denial, of disassociation. All of that relativism of projection, perception, personality. All of this relativism, where we say, yes, the light, but say, oh, the light is here, nice here, but over there's the darkness. Or yes, the oneness is good here, but over there, the division. Yes, the love is great here, but over there, oh, the terrible hate. You know, it's always relative. So the Holy Spirit knows the non-relative, and it knows how to bridge that trouble of continuity. We have a continuity problem. We're not used to the non-relative. We're super used to the relative. We have been like a fish swimming in an ocean for uncountable, unmeasurable time, it seems like. The ocean of relativism. So the non-relative, we say, well, what's that? I mean, the non-relative is not related, it's different than the relative. So it's non-relative compared to the relative, or comparing, where the non-relative is incomparable. There's no comparing. You cannot compare it with relativism. It's singular. It's singular. So what we do here in continuity practice is we actually work to align ourselves with that non-relative, by using what we got right now, concepts, words, pointing us in that direction, helping us out, and practicing. So, we will do a little practice here. And this is continuity practice. It's not the experience, it's continuity practice. We have a fear and dread. Oh, what if I step from the relative into the non-relative? What will I do? What will I do? What will I think? What will I say? How will I conceptualize it? How will I symbolize it? Well, symbols may flow, concepts may flow. All of you may experience a flowing, actually. But, and in fact, it's possible you may. I know there have been times when I seem to have something has happened where a breakthrough happens of some sort, and suddenly this flow of incredible beauty of forms and symbols, and just this flow. Yeah, I'm just sitting there watching this flow, watching the river flow, watching the river flow, yeah. Let the river flow, let the river flow. Let the river flow. But that is not it in itself. That is simply our brain, our mind, whatever you want to call it, conceptualizing. Which is, if it happens, it happens. Fine. Don't worry about it. Just don't fixate on it. Don't fixate on it. Because what's more important is the floating, is the effortlessness of it. So let's use some terms to describe, as it were, to point towards God's non-relative, beautiful, living light of remembrance. God's non-relative, beautiful, living light of remembrance. Its purpose is to remind us, the light itself reminds us, the fact that it rests on everything equally is what reminds us. The quality that it has of this impersonal, non-judgmental, all-inclusive, and we will talk about some of the qualities of this light as we get ready to abide in it, to glide in it. God's non-relative, beautiful, living light of remembrance is non-reducible. It is undiminishable. It is non-wavering. It is never leaning. It is favoritism-free. It is specialness-free. It is non-reactive. It is balance-free. It is non-engaging. It is non-improving. It is non-judgmental. It is non-referential. It is non-becoming. It is process-free. It is non-thoughtful. It is consideration-free. It is action-free. It is non-energetic. It is non-preferential. It is non-focused. It is non-directed. It is non-dancing. It is non-imposing. It is non-dual. It is non-timely. It is non-rewarding, non-presenting, non-searching, non-finding, non-discovering, non-pending, non-ending, non-striking, non-interactive, non-permissive, and non-decisive. Ultimately, it's beyond all of these descriptions. It is non-descriptable. It is non-describable. It is non-nameable, non-describable. And yet, because we have a continuity problem, it is necessary to use description to erode our sense that we need to depend upon description. All right, we think we need to depend upon description, but what we're seeing here, it's not any of these descriptions. It's unswitchable. I mean, you can't switch it. Well, what is non-switchable in the world? It's non-reactive. What is non-reactive in the world? Nothing. Everything is reactive in some way. Maybe gold doesn't react. Unpourable, you know, uneatable, non-adjustable. What is non-adjustable conceptually? Everything seems to be adjustable, right, in this world. You can adjust to anything. But this is non-adjustable. So it doesn't have any qualities that we can name, right, that we're used to naming. We say, oh, no, we can't say, well, it's adjustable. No, it's non-adjustable. But what's that? What's that? It's beyond. It's beyond. It's beyond, right? It's non-adjustable. It's unmeltable. 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 So, we will continue on with some of these qualities that it's ungenerated. Ungenerated. Sourceless. Sourceless. Data-free. Non-collectible. Non-stackable. Non-hoardable, non-dimmable, non-learnable, non-teachable, thought-free, ever-present, uncommoditizable, unownable, never-absent, unshining, meaning with a severe intensity, unshining, non-intense, non-intense, unfocused, directionless, non-reflected, non-fadable, unfluctuating, non-pulsing, unobscured, unenlightenable, non-containable, unpackable, fact-free, unmeasurable, non-explainable, non-technical, impersonal, untransmittable, all-merciful, never-ending, ever-steady, non-energetic. So what we're doing, we're getting used to describing something that is beyond description.
Interesting.
In this practice. Because as we talk about practicing all these qualities we're talking about, we're saying, that doesn't fit anything, does it? It doesn't fit there, but it does point, it gives us a comfort zone with this light, this God's non-relative, beautiful living light of remembrance. It is that. And this helps us as we continue on. We say it is non-reducible, undiminishable. Or did I just say that? I probably just said that. Okay, it is unswitchable. It is wire free. It is wave form free. It is particle free. It is non-transformable. It is unsplittable. It is motionless. It is non-adjustable. I said that before. It is the light of being. It is unbendable. It is non-distortable. It is unconvertible. It is uncultivatable. It is unharvestable. It is unplantable. It is unstorable. It is unmeltable. It is non-flammable. It is non-reactive. It is unpourable. It is undrillable. It is unedible. It is undrinkable. It is non-flowing. It is non-flowering. It is non-reproducible. It is non-touchable. It is, you could say, intangible. It is non-transferable. It is non-graftable. It is unfathomable. It is non-manageable. It is non-catchable. It is non-workable. It is non-shapeable, non-moldable, non-compressible. So we're getting used to a description, a mental, conceptual, symbolic, a constellation of description that doesn't fit anything in the world at all, does it? But we're getting used to that. We're getting used to that. It's like a way to encourage ourselves. I have a little bit of decaf coffee here. It's supposed to keep me warm out here, but it's probably cold. It's quite cold outside. Here. Relatively so. I'm sure people in other places of the world think it's quite balmy here right now. We're just getting a comfort zone of description. Should our mind want to fall back, as it may, into description, all these descriptions are here for us. We know, if we need to, a flow of description, descriptiveness, then descriptiveness can flow. You know, sure, that too can flow. Imagery can flow, descriptiveness can flow, and you just let it flow. You don't need to freak out about it or anything. Imagery can flow. But what we're interested in is the non-relativeness of it. That too, the light of God's remembrance, that too, rests upon that too. It rests upon that imagery too. It rests upon that descriptive flow of descriptiveness too. This flow of beautiful flow, it rests upon that too. It rests upon everything equally. So what we do is we, even if there's this flow of symbology and beautiful imagery, etc., like a flow of just flowing through our mind, like wow, we keep saying, focusing on beyond that, on the completely non-relative, the descriptive free, the unfadable, the unfluctuating. And we keep attuning to that and keep resting and abiding in that. We just let the river flow. If there's a river flowing, just let it flow. We don't need to push it. We don't need to do anything with the river flowing. If it's a river of description, of it in any particular way, a flow of flowers, it could be a river full of flowers just flowing. Just let the river flow. Don't try to do anything. Just continue to sit and say, God's lovely living light of remembrance is non-reducible. It is non-focused. It is undiminishable. It is non-wavering. And so we can continue to tune into it. Like I said, there are times when I lie down to go to sleep and just this unbelievable flow of seamless symbols and imagery, and like a movie, it just happens. I'm just watching. But then it stops. You don't see. So it's relative. It's ending. It comes and it goes. It comes and it goes. I remember Punjaji, a teacher from India, Lucknow, India, went to see Ramana Maharshi, teacher from Arunachala, Tiruvannamalai, southern India. And Ramana Maharshi asked him, "Where have you been?" He was absent for a while. And he said, "I was on the other side of Arunachala Mountain." "What were you doing?" "I was playing with Krishna." "I said, playing with Krishna?" "Yeah, I saw Krishna. I see Krishna. I've seen him since I was a child, and I'm playing with Krishna. It's just wonderful." And Ramana Maharshi said, "Well, where is Krishna now?" And Punjaji said, he's gone. And Ramana Maharshi said, "Whatever comes and goes is not the self. It's not the self. It's not the absolute. It is not the true vision of oneness. It's not God's lovely living light of remembrance." In the East, they refer to this vision of oneness as the self, abide in the self. Here we use the vision of oneness, the vision of Christ. Abide in the vision of Christ. Christ means oil, actually. And it refers to the complete, equally spread out nature of God's lovely living light of remembrance as it bathes everything, as it rests upon everything equally, like oil, like everything is anointed. Christ referred to the anointed one, the anointed one. It refers to the vision of oneness, that everything seems to be anointed with this lovely living light of remembrance. And we abide as that. We abide with that awareness, experiencing. We experience that, just abide with that experiencing. So, even, you know, sure there can be lovely symbology flow. The brain may symbolize it. That's what it does, right? So the brain may be symbolizing it. Don't fight it. Don't fight it. Don't fight it. Just don't idolize it. Don't deify it. Don't idolize it. Ramana said, hey, what comes and goes is not what you're aiming for. Even though it's symbolized as Krishna, it's a symbol of Krishna. It's imagination, a symbol of projected imagination. Of course, religious people are apt to project a symbolization of their deities, of course. The Christian, Judeo-Christian tradition will see. What will they see? Maybe they'll see the Virgin Mary. "Oh, the Virgin Mary has appeared to me. There she is. I see her." It's a projection of their imagination. Perhaps in reaction to a momentary holy instant of the vision of oneness, the brain will symbolize it and project it as an image there, as a person, as something we described and seen as a relative, something relative. And there's the Virgin Mary, there's her cloak, and she's smiling and praying and speaking to me or whatever. It's a psychic projection. It's a projection of her imagination. The God's lovely living light of remembrance is not reified. It is not concretized. It's not a person. It doesn't appear as a person. Because that doesn't remind us of reality. What reminds us of reality is the anointment of everything by this light. It anoints everything, every place, all thoughts, emotions, feelings, concepts, imagination, projection, things, places, everything. Everything is equally anointed. It's the equal anointing of everything that reminds us of reality. Not some deity, you know, praying there in robes. That just feeds concretization, and then it comes and it goes. Where is it now? It's gone. So it's still relative, coming and going. Where can everywhere come from and where can it go to? There is no coming and going. Where can it enter and where can it exit? There's no entrance, there's no exit to it, right? No entrance, no exit. No coming, no going. No inside, no outside. How can there be an inside to everywhere? Consider that for just a moment. How can we talk about, well, I'm in the inside of everywhereness. I just entered into the inside of everywhereness. Or, where did I come from? Well, I came from the outside of everywhereness. I exited the outside of everywhereness and I entered into the inside of everywhereness. How is that possible? Consider that for a moment. So this is relativism. If the Virgin Mary arises, if the Virgin Guadalupe, if Jesus Christ, if Krishna, what do they call it? Various goddesses and gods and goddesses of various traditions and various holy figures. If an image of them arises, just let it arise, let it arise, let it arise. That too. The God's lovely living light of remembrance rests upon that too. Say, God's lovely living light of remembrance rests upon this too. God's beautiful living light of remembrance rests upon this too, as it is. As it rests upon this plant, as it is. As it rests upon this table, as it is. So sure, if imagery arises, just say, that too, this too, this too, this too. This thought too is overlaid. This, it rests upon this thought too. God's lovely living light of remembrance rests upon this too as it is. Rests upon this too as it is, or just as it is. Rests upon this as it is. This too is anointed. This too is anointed as it is. This too is. So there's the Virgin Mary. This too is anointed as it is. There's a mountain. This too is anointed as it is. And there's a dirt. This too is anointed as it is. And there's plants, vegetation. This vegetation too is anointed with God's lovely living light of remembrance, as it is. There's a thought, there's a fearful thought, this fearful thought too, as it is anointed. A loving thought, this loving thought too is anointed. Any thought we have, doesn't matter what it is. What condition, this condition too, is anointed by God's lovely living light of remembrance. Everything, as it is anointed. So, if there are things that arise in your mind, just let the arising happen. This too is anointed. This too. That's where we have to get to. Now, it could be said that we don't particularly want these deified figures to appear because the tendency is to say, oh, this is where the anointment is and not somewhere else. Because you see the goddess there and you say, oh, she's so beautiful, she's so sacred, she's so divine, she's so holy, and I'll worship you forever, and I'm fixated on you, and all this stuff. That's not what we want to have happen at all. No. Because that doesn't remind us of reality at all. There's no specialness or favoritism or special divinity in reality. Everything is equally divine. And it's beyond even that. It just is divine. It just is. It knows itself to be divine. Reality knows itself to be real. That's all we can say. It knows itself to be real. So the anointment of God's living light, God's lovely living light of remembrance, the anointment is on everything, including our thoughts and our opinions and our judgments and our likes and our dislikes, our frailties and our strengths, our weaknesses, our strengths. It's on everything equally. It's everything is anointed. There's nothing not anointed. Nothing not anointed. This too is anointed. This too is anointed. This too is anointed. This, but when you get this, the goddess herself, as it were, we think, oh, here's the anointing, here's the anointing, and poof, we've lost it, just like that. It turns into an idol, immediately. It's an idol now. We don't want idols. Some traditions insist that they don't use human personas. For instance, Islam, I believe, doesn't allow statues, doesn't allow people to symbolize. Okay. And I think in Protestant churches, they don't allow some statues inside, etc. Okay. Various other traditions. If you're part of that tradition, you will know what it's like. But I would say, whatever it is, we have to keep in mind the basics of the situation. Whether you happen to have statues and your tradition uses imagery, human imagery, or person's imagery, or whatever, or even things' imagery. The important thing is to remember everything equally anointed. Do not fixate on anything and say, this is sacred, this is holy, more so than anything else. Then you don't have the vision of oneness. You're not being reminded of reality. You're into idolatry, actually. And of course, some religions say the great sin is idolatry, which is, it is one way of saying it, yes. I mean, the ultimate problem is the continuity problem. But the continuity problem, everything has its roots in the continuity problem. So the tendency to idolatry is a very bad tendency. It is something you don't want to, you want to work on that as much as possible, which is what we're doing here. Because I, too, as most everyone, struggle with this whole thing, with this situation. No question about it. It is a great struggle. And of course, the admonition, do not fall into idolatry. Don't be idolaters. Well, it's easier said than done. You need a blueprint. You need a plan. You need spiritual practice. You need to really work at it, work at it, work at it, work at it, work at it. Because we think we're a body, and so we are a thing, and we think, oh, there's a divine thing, I'm divine too, my body's divine too, I can be divine too, there's the goddess, I can be divine like that. No, we're not, we're supposed to be reminded that we're not our body, we're spirit. We are singular, we are one, we are invulnerable, we're non-material, we're formless, timeless, eternal life. And so we're reminded of our true nature by the equal anointing of God's lovely living light of remembrance, the equal anointing of everything. Every stone, every atom, every particle, every brick, every bit of mortar, every bit of dirt, every bit of vegetation, every bit of water, moisture, everything, every thought, every reaction, every love, every hatred, every insecurity, every ugliness, every beauty, everything, equally anointed. Now for sure, in all the traditions, there have been those who have seen the vision of oneness, because the traditions, in the high part of those traditions, you can get this, you can get this, you realize someone somewhere, and maybe quite a few, have really got it. They know. But In today's world, we are so distracted that it's easy to just overlook this, overlook it. It's the age of distraction. We live in the age of distraction, to tell you the truth. It's a mania, actually. We live in a manic time, a maniacal time, actually. If you look back at this time, we'll say it was totally maniacal. Totally maniacal. So we have to get after it here. We cannot just trust the times we live in to be beneficent for us. They're not beneficent. They're not beneficent. I'm looking and evaluating at all the different, so many different groups and you know, stuff, spiritual stuff that's going on in the world. And I just say, wow, they're not really getting after it. Kind of coasting and trusting in the times too much. Don't trust in these times. Do not trust in these times. Don't trust in any times, actually, but especially these times. These are the times that require us to really get after practicing, even though we may think we hate it. We may say, I'm sure I'm going to hate it. No, it's not. It's not hateful. It's actually kind of enjoyable. It's not so tough. Easier than all this homework that I didn't do in school. I basically refused to do homework in school because I said, this is a waste of my time. I don't care if I get an F, it's a waste of my time. Then I'd figure out a way to get an A, but it was just, you know, eventually that didn't work, you know, in college and stuff so well. But I said, this is a complete waste of time. There must be something better. There has to be something better. Now, what about music? Okay, that's what I used to be into. It's not as good as this sort of practice. It's not as good. Because what music does, it gives you this flow. A flow. Okay, that's fine. But what we're doing is what is the flow? What is anointing the flow? This flow too is anointed. So our view is on the anointment of the flow. Okay, so if you have a flow of holy imagery, fine. But the anointment is on this holy imagery. It's also on everything there is. Every thought, even every negative thought, every hateful thought, every murderous thought, every unkindness, every severity, everything barbaric, everything distracted, everything fleshy, everything pagan, everything. It's anointing everything equally. Just the same as it's anointing this flow of holy imagery. Just the same. That's what's important. Only that is important. Otherwise, we'll miss it. We'll miss it. We'll get into idolatry for sure. For sure. And our habits are so idolatrous. Our habits are so idolatrous. I can give you descriptions, etc. But when we almost automatically, when we come across a reminder, a true reminder of our divinity, we begin to try to idolize it. Automatically. It's just boom, like that. And we're so used to it, even though we know it's wrong, we seem helpless. We're helpless to stop it. So, we have to get down to practicing, and so it's not so bad. I'm just trying to help myself out and trying to help share this help with everybody in the world who wants to get after it. And I just pray that the Holy Spirit makes use of this little effort here, because it's something, it is an effort. It is an effort that's happening here. And to go beyond music is a real tough one for me, I'll tell you that. Because what I did before was I tried to compose the most beautiful music possible. And I did compose some that was pretty amazingly beautiful. Same with graphics. I developed a skill in graphics, and I'm able to produce some graphics that are just like jaw-dropping. But I don't put them up. I don't post them. No. I just like the music. I try to back away from that. Say no. That's not it. It's not it. We have to go one step further. Then even the most beautiful imagery, the most beautiful music, we have to go one step further than that right now. Because that gets us into idolatry, and it can be a huge problem. In fact, it is a huge problem. We have to take one more little step. So that's all I've done. I've switched my composing ability, compositional ability, into making these practices. How I'm able to do this is because in a previous life, and maybe in several, I know I was a composer. I was a prolific composer and worked at it every single day of my life. And so comes natural to me. It's just, I could just do it. It's just discipline, determination, discipline, drive. You have to do it. It's very important. Get down to the work and just workaholic. So I was a workaholic. And so I've taken this capacity to compose music and I've turned it towards spiritual compositions of practice, spiritual practices. This is a higher use of will. It's a higher use of will, no question about it. It didn't come easy. It's a big turnaround, for sure. Because music seems so pleasing, right? It's so tickling our ears. It's so pleasing. It's like, wow, I can get... you do a music video, just look at it, like 14 million views, 20 million views. They put it up 1 week, 2 million views. Because people love music, don't they? It tickles their ears. Oh, it's so fluffy and tickly and wonderful. Yeah, I said, well, I could do that easily. If I was in the right situation, I could spin out endless, beautiful composition, musical compositions. Piece of cake, actually. Just work at it and just do it. And there's a lot of work involved, for sure. It's hard work. But there'd be no problem. However, it doesn't get the job done. It doesn't really, it sort of makes us try to feel good about our idolatry, our relativism, basically. It says, you know what, we're really in a terrible situation, but I got this music I can listen to, so it's not so bad, maybe. It doesn't get the job done. So I just realized that let's work on something that's not going to be so popular. The popularity isn't there. And it probably, never will be there, actually. What about religious songs? Like we're in church and they're singing. And does that get into... No. That's a feel-good thing. Now, some songs are better than others, that is true. Some of the religious songs of the Middle Ages and other, they're not pop and not, hey, let's rock it, rock this thing. The old, like, Agnes Dei, different type of music, that type of, you can't even hardly call it music, it's more of a sacred tonation. That has some promise to it in some regards. Yes, what we're doing here is more condensed, more intense, and it's harder to spin off. Problem is, if you get involved in music, it's so easy to start spinning it off into interest. Let me listen to some jazz, some blues, some rock, some reggae, blah blah blah, on and on and on, and you kind of become very musical. Whereas this, it's more focused. It doesn't tend to spin off into anything very well, actually. It just is what it is. So this is what I'm able to do, and just sit down and just do it. And so I'm doing it. And I don't want to go back to composing music. That's been there, done that. And idolatry loves music. They say, why don't you make some beautiful music for me? The goddess says, oh, if you can make some beautiful music for me, you'll be even more attached to me. I'll appear even more beautiful to you. Right? That's not what we're after. And I did that. I made some music to for the goddess and to extol her virtues, how beautiful. But that just fixates us on her, right? That doesn't solve our problem at all. Our problem is we need to see everything equally anointed. The good, the bad, and the ugly. That's what we need. Nothing short of that's going to work. Because in reality, there are no favorites. Everything is everything. There's no good, no bad, and ugly at all. So we have to be reminded of reality. What is the quality of reality? What is the nature of reality? The all-inclusiveness, the non-judgmentalness, the complete, they're all in all, the all in all, the complete singularity in itself, the everywhereness, no inside, no outside to it. We have to be reminded of that. So we do have to experience this non-relative, lovely living light of remembrance. So we'll keep on plugging away at this. Keep on plugging away at this. Hey, all right, Cat's trying to drink this. That's enough. There's actually a baseball game on. I'm going to treat myself to that. Baseball season has started, but we're still full blast here. Full blast here. Thanks for watching. Thanks for the comments. Thanks for the support, the likes, everything. It helps a lot because this is not easy for anybody. It is not easy to take this step, one little step beyond the feel-good stuff, right? Into this very kind of abstract, not this, netty, non-reducible, non-describable, non-nameable, you know, unswitchable, ungenerated, sourceless, unobscured, thought-free, never absent, always giving, never ending, non-striking, non-dual, totally seems abstract. It's not easy, but it's doable. We can do it. We can do it. We're doing it. Just keep it up. Keep it going right now, because there's 1,000 TV stations and 10,000 more on your tablet, your pad, your smartphone, on wherever you go. You can take all 10,000 channels of idolatry with you wherever you go. We live in a maniacal time of idolatry. We cannot allow ourselves to be pulled down on that. So just use your will to keep practicing. Very great. That's it.